I would like to call upon stage the man who's the voice and the face of the TMC and Mamata Banerjee in Delhi. We've seen him championing the cause, sometimes even single-handedly, of the opposition in Parliament. May I please call upon Mr. Derek O'Brien, Rajya Sabha MP, the Trinamool Congress Party. Very good morning, Mr. O'Brien.
Good morning. And we have an important thing to do today, which is more important than any session. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in wishing Preeti a very happy birthday.
Well, you're very kind, sir. Thank you. I think, you know, we're doing it on national television. It's a first, but thank you. I appreciate it, sir. I hope you'd be kind.
This is your first birthday you're celebrating on national television?
Yes, sir. Thank you. But let's quickly now move on before...
To lesser important things.
Yes, to... Well, no, for bigger important things at this point of time. Mr. O'Brien, we've seen you over the past couple of months, sometimes, like I said, single-handedly championing the cause of the opposition. We saw you in Hathras getting roughed up by the police. We saw you rush to the well of the house when the farm laws were going on. We saw you get suspended. We saw you squat outside the parliament after that. Very recently, about 4 days ago, we also saw you being named in the speech by the Prime Minister, where he said, Mr. O'Brien, when you talk about freedom of expression, when you talk about intimidation, very good, good speech, but make it in your own state. Today, your party, sir, stands charged with exactly what you charge the BJP in the center of running a fascist state.
Well, firstly, in all those various events you saw, not events, those situations you saw me, I was there simply because I was wearing a Mamata Banerjee jersey. When you wear the Mamata Banerjee jersey, you look good. So whether it was Hathras, whether it was Singhu on the border, this is the way Mamata Di looks at the way she looks at life. So on the 4th of December, in fact, we went to that farmer border and I said, do I go there now? So she said, yes, go there, but make sure there are no television cameras. Just quietly go there with 3-4 MPs and listen to people. Don't give any bites also. So I think that's the whole thing about the way Didi looks at it. This particular one you're talking about is that the Prime Minister's speech where he mentioned...
He said that I heard many Derek O'Brien ji ko suna, unhone freedom of expression, intimidation, jaise shabd istamal ki, achhe shabd hain, jaake apni state mein sunaiyega.
Preeti, I'll answer this in two parts. Firstly, we raised 11 issues there about how this government had failed the country. They had failed to maintain the sanctity of parliament. They had failed to protect migrant workers. They had failed to boost the economy. They had failed India's women and children. They had failed on the prep for COVID. All these. We were expecting some answers on any of these 11 issues. Did we get any answers from the Prime Minister? No. Two, this is the classic case of playing the victim card. This is a classic case, if you go back even to World War II, when you are the aggressor, when you are the bully, bully is actually a very slight word, when you are the intimidator, that's the time you come here and hope to play victim. This is the strategy of MSP. MSP as in not in, this is Modi-Shah partnership.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so this is their strategy. So this is their strategy to come to Bengal to intimidate. But the lady sitting on this chair yesterday at 5:30 in the evening has ensured that people like us, be it MPs, be it MLAs, and more importantly, be it the Trinamool workers on the ground, we shall not be intimidated by the tourist gang because they keep coming here. Let them keep coming here. That's the. If it was such a fascist state, how come Mr. Modi, Mr. Shah, and their minions all come and make speeches here every day and make false promises every day and tell the people that the Citizenship Amendment Act is coming and now they're spinning it around and saying it's not coming. So you're coming here, you're making your speeches, but we're not going to give you lollipops when you come here. You're coming here and fighting a political battle. So come, here's the suggestion. You come and tell us what you have done for this country in the last 6 years. We will tell you what Mamata Banerjee and the Trinamool Congress have done for the last 10 years, and then let people decide. India today is one of the few quote-unquote independent platforms where you present both sides of the stories. I think it'll be wonderful if you have on television Mamata Banerjee versus Prime Minister Modi. You'll only need one teleprompter for that. But then you'll have Dr. Amit Mitra debate the economy with Nirmala ji. Or you'll have Mr. Amit Shah choose whoever he wants from Trinamool. We'll debate him on Parliament. And we'll do a tutorial on Parliament. That you can't bring, you can't say you're going to put a farm laws on hold. What do you mean you're going to put the farm laws on hold? Understand, I think they're missing Arun Jaitley, because Arun Jaitley would never have allowed this to happen, because he told them, listen, when you pass three bills and you want to put a pause on it, there's a method. You have to bring another bill. You have to repeal those three bills. But then this is different. This is the Gujarat Gymkhana trying to be the government of India.
Mr. O'Brien, you say that we're a neutral channel. We wear our neutrality with immense pride.
Most of the time.
No, sir. All the time. Okay, it might not suit you.
Priti, it's your birthday. I'm trying to lighten things up, you know.
No, sir, but let me come back to it. Like I said, we wear our neutrality with immense pride. Therefore, I'll come back to the question I began with. You say that you're not a fascist state, is the charge which is made by the BJP.
Of course not. This is their victim card. Listen, you have to understand this. Now, during the lockdown, it gave us a lot of extra reading, you know, to do. I mean, Naomi Klein, I think she's in her 50s, she's written this fabulous book, which I was reading during the lockdown. It's fabulous, you know? And she tries to explain how this is done. It's called shock therapy. Mm-hmm. This is what is being done. You're talking about cult. Okay. What is shock therapy? Shock therapy is the ability to intimidate and influence through shock.
Okay.
How is it done? You go and after you intimidate, then you influence. So what do? You announce demonetization at 4 hours notice. Bang! And then you hope to change perception. It's another matter that within 2 hours, Chief Minister of West Bengal said, withdraw this draconian decision. No other party said it, only one. More shock therapy. Bang, you announce. Another 4 hour lockdown, 21 day lockdown, 4 hours notice. Bang! Monday morning, you bring Article 370. You bring it in Parliament. Another occasion, farmer bill, bang. No ordinance, no select committee, no scrutiny, bang. This is what is known as shock therapy.
Okay.
And shock therapy is a strategy to intimidate, to influence, if you're talking about cult. The people who do this cult, you know, they're a good cult. I mean, I don't want to get into dictionary definitions, but as I understand it, there's a cult and there's an icon. There's a good, like, I was, you know, a Beatles fan. You know, you grow your long hair and you... That's cult. Rajesh Khanna, to me, when I was in middle school, to me, Rajesh Khanna was an iconic positive. There's also the bad cult, Jonestown massacres in the 70s, where 900 people died. 300 of those people were below the age of 17. The cult gave in California gave them all cyanide, so they all drank the cyanide. So we need to be careful.
Okay.
And we need to rationally ask questions and not allow the cult to happen.
All right, sir. Let me ask you a question when we talk about freedom of expression.
Preeti, I just want to give you two pictures. If you allow me to paint two pictures, because otherwise all these words I've used will not get across what is the cult and what is the ideology.
Paint the picture, sir, then I'll ask
two
my
pictures
question.
Only.
Yes.
So one picture is during COVID. There is this lady, COVID is just like March, April, March. There is this lady who goes to the marketplaces and everyone's trying to communicate through words, through graphs, is how do you do physical distancing? What does she do? She goes there and she starts drawing
circles.
Circles. Not perfect circles, but she starts doing circles. Now that's one photograph of COVID. Here's the second photograph. Garden, man, peacock.
All right, sir. Can I ask my question? Yeah. We talk about freedom of expression. Last week in Alipur North, one BJP worker was arrested for a Facebook post. Last year, Saifukul Islam, Arambagh TV editor, arrested because he exposed corruption. Last year, BJP girl from Howrah young girl, 21, arrested for a Facebook post. How are we different than what's happening in the country?
Very nice. It takes me back to my first argument, victim card. You've given me three names.
I can give you more, sir, but then...
I'll give you only one. Allow me one.
Yes.
Again, trying to play the victim card when you are the intimidator. Here's it. I'll give you only one. 2018, location, Rajasthan, rally. Here's the quote. My Hindi is very bad, so I won't try. I'll in English. We can make fake news turn true. We can make the truth turn fake. Jo sach, wo jhuta kar denge, aur wo jhuta hai, wo sach kar denge. Mulayam ji ko thappad mara uska ladka, Akhilesh ji. That's the quote, unquote. How do we do this? Hum log kaisa karenge? Hamara 31 WhatsApp groups hai. Who said this? Video. The Home Minister of India. The Home Minister of India said this. By the way, he may have said this because he was distracted in 2018. I don't know why he said it. Last night in Calcutta, at the Science City Auditorium, if you look at what he said this in a more decorative way for the Bengal elections. So again, I say, stop playing the victim. Fake news today, IT cell and all small things.
Are these names fake news? Were these arrests fake news? Did these arrests happen?
I don't know
these.
I gave you a bigger example about the. But if you're looking at Mamata Banerjee's Trinamool Congress government, of course you can pick up 1, 2, 3 examples from anywhere. I'm giving you a more macro issue where the Home Minister of India is telling 31 lakh WhatsApp groups to go out and do. Sometimes Mr. Shah and Mr. Modi, we expect, listen, he's our Prime Minister. He's our Home Minister. So we expect a little bit of dignity. We expect a little bit of grace. What happened to all these little things which we'd normally expect? They're missing. And I think it's showing in Parliament also. You know, there was a bonhomie in Central Hall where you could go and have a coffee without bothering as to what jersey you were. And those were nice coffees. And that time it was subsidized. Now I think we have to pay a little more. But that is missing. I think there's a decency. And I saw what Mamata Di said yesterday. Yeah, we can be very decent. But then you come here, then...
She also said to be fearless and report. But if you're going to be arresting editors, then how can you be fearless
and
report?
I don't know this.
Shafiqul Islam, Arambagh TV editor, last year. But let me move on. Let's move on from there, sir. You also had a Mahua Moitra, who's an MP, in her constituency called journalists, do paise ka journalists. And at the same time, you say that journalists need to be respected, journalists need to be honored. How does it work?
Well, firstly, since you brought up Mahua's name, Mahua, Professor Shogota Roy, and Trinamool, in the last 10 days, for everybody, anyone who thinks that there is no opposition in India, quote unquote, we must give credit where it is due. The Trinamool is speaking out in Parliament. This one issue, since she said it, and it was her personal opinion, I think in all fairness to her, the next time she is on your channel, you can ask her why she said it, and she'll certainly give you a reason why she said it. But you saw yesterday the way Mamata Di not only respects journalists, she has a lot of time, and she's a very emotional lady, right? So she's a very emotional person. But you see, not only does she respect journalists, she speaks out. And sometimes, she spoke on, but this is the way she does it. She has a fabulous relationship, not only with journalists, because of the small things she does with people. And you know, you keep talking about cult, and these are the little things which mean a lot. I don't know if you've ever traveled with Mamata Di, or if you've seen her at an airport. And sometimes we find it difficult to follow her example.
Follow her, because she's quite quick on her feet.
try to walk with her.
Yeah, yeah.
No, I've never tried. I tried once or twice in Delhi. Very early, I got to know that don't go there. Okay, because she can do. She can multitask also on the on that treadmill.
Yeah, yeah.
But she gets into the airline queue. She goes into the airline, the bus, and she travels in the bus. That's the way. So hers is not a put on. Hers is not a peacock photo opportunity. Hers is, Mamta Di, what you see and what you get. Now, don't get me wrong. In all this, there is deep ideology. It's not photo op. And by deep ideology means sometimes you can disagree with her, but in the long run, you'll know the ideology. For example, the best example is her view on land acquisition and farmers. The most consistent is Didi. Demonetization. Let me tell you a story. As soon as this demonetization happened, the true story, we were all kind of thinking what to say. It happened about 8 o'clock, 8:30, the usual time for shock, shock therapy time. So, and suddenly, boom, went this tweet from Mamta Di. Withdraw this draconian design. So many are thinking, oh gosh, did we consult any economist? Did we consult? No, she just did it. And what happened? 10 days or 2 weeks later, we were in parliament. And I was told, let's get some political parties together. We'll march from parliament to Rashtrapati Bhavan. Nobody came, Preeti. Only Shiv Sena, excuse me, and Omar Abdullah, we called him and said he came down. That was it. She said, go for it. Another example, you talk about ideology. Farm bill. Shingur, everybody knows, 26-day hunger strike. But when the farm bills came to parliament, I remember that, 2013, the bill was about to be voted on. I went out to Central Hall because there's no network in... Actually, there is network in Rajya Sabha, but that's a secret. But you come to Central Hall and I made a call saying that it looks like we are going to be in single digit votes in Rajya Sabha opposing this bill. Single digits. And the other side is like huge. And I'm not talking about BJP, by the way. Huh?
Okay.
This is Congress-BJP partnership. Because that was 2013. So she said, how many? I said, maybe 7, maybe 8. She's saying, even if it's 3, oppose the bill with a division. Means you have to, not a voice vote. We opposed that bill in 2013. Check the records of parliament. 7 votes of Trinamool against the bill in 2013. What happened after that? What did Supreme Court say in 2016? That's the law. BJP government after that came. They brought a bill with a modified bill. What has happened to land? Today, India's view on land, which is industry must benefit, farmers must not be conned, okay, is Mamata Banerjee's view. It's not the Congress view or the BJP view.
All right, okay. Mr. O'Brien, you talk about how different, you know, you gave us those two splitting images. But away from the optics of the circle and the peacock, would you reckon there are huge amounts of similarities with Mr. Modi and Mamata Banerjee? Both, you talk about cult, both are cult figures. Both are, you know, run their party with an iron hand. They pretty much manage affairs, micromanage affairs. Would you reckon, do you see a similarity between the two? You're talking about personalities. We'll talk about ideology as well and what the Trinamool ideology is.
For me, a cult figure is a negative figure. So Mamata Banerjee can never be a cult figure.
Do you see any similarities between Modi and Mamata?
And the two people you're talking about is someone who I have admired, respected, loved and look up to from 2004. That's a long time. The other gentleman, I see him when parliament is on for about 7 minutes during question hour. How can you even think about comparing these two people? I mean, I think with all due respect to the Honorable Prime Minister, you can't compare. This, in a difficult political, in a mostly misogynistic political environment, to make it first. Mamata Banerjee, everyone talks about the fight with the CPM. No, read so many of her books. Her first fight was not against CPM. Her first fight was against the pressures she was through the 80s and the 90s after Rajiv Gandhi's death with the Congress party. That was her first big battle.
So you see no similarities at all.
After that came what? She was down to one MP. One MP. Who in the... From one MP to 26 MLAs, look where she is today. So, it's a very different, you know, you can't compare chai and, you know, I can't do this because A, I don't know the second gentleman, but I'll give you three examples. One, demonetization. Who handled it better? Mamata. Let's talk about, this is not about people, this is about...
Mamata Banerjee reacted to demonetization.
Not reacted.
Mr. O'Brien.
Not reacted. Why on the other day you get a... what did she say? Withdraw this draconian decision. Give me 50 days and after that, any punishment is good for me. Trash. Trash. What happened after 50 days? Come on. Let's get real. All the hype and the hoopla and everything else. Where has Narendra Modi and Amit Shah delivered? Compared, delivered. We're talking about comparing one lady with chappals with a man in a Kashmiri shawl. That's not important.
Those are optics, sir. Those are optics.
This is not about optics. This is about ideology. What do you believe in? Do you believe that those farmers... Do you believe that a bill can be passed in Rajya Sabha in that way? Can you believe that be it Congress MPs or CPM MPs or Trinamool MPs standing there and asking for a division? It's my right as my... Not as an MP. It is my right as a citizen of India to ask for a vote. Why didn't you ask for a vote? Why? You really want to know the story why? With all respect to the chairman, because Modi and Shah told them, no vote, pass this bill. So, Mamata Di has a deep ideology. GST, what did you do for GST? We were pro-GST. We all cooperated with Mr. Jetley. Dr. Mitra was the chairman of the Empowerment Committee. What did you do? You just screwed up the implementation of GST.
So we
start comparing. Yes, you have every right as a journalist to ask me about comparing. But one delivers. The other doesn't deliver. And only hype. Another hype will come yesterday. Citizenship Amendment Act. Where is your Citizenship Amendment Act? Where? You want to talk real parliament? You want to talk real issues? When a bill gets passed in both houses of parliament, sorry, Preeti. When a bill gets passed both houses of parliament, what happens? President signs it. Within 6 months, you have to have the rules. All bills. Within 6 months, 95-99%, the rules are made. What have you done with the Citizenship Act? You say no rules. 6 months, no rules. 3 months, no rules. 3 months, no rules. Now you're saying COVID.
All right, sir. So
Murgi mat banao. Murgi mat banao. And that is why, with all humility, we really do believe this kind of mahol banane, we will win this seats, we will win that seats. I heard what the number Mamata Di gave yesterday. I heard. And I heard the number
Mr. Shah gave. 200 se upar purn bahumat.
So there aren't 400 seats in the... There aren't 400 seats in the assembly, na? Please call us back at next year's conclave to see whether the lady with the chappals were right or the manager of the tourist gang was right.
All right. Now, we have 7 minutes. We are going to go express on all our questions. You talk about ideology, sir. The TMC ideology, what is the constructive ideology of the TMC? It's steeped in anti-left, anti-Congress. If there is no Mamata, what is the TMC ideology? You already have defection. You have an Adhiranjan Chaudhary who comes out and says, merge with us.
I'm a little sad that you're asking me this now. I've just told you on land what is our ideology. I've just told you when we give out a health card here in Bengal, 10 crore health cards are being given out. That's our ideology. It's a blue card. It doesn't matter. A blood test is not done to check whether you're Hindu, Muslim, Christian, Buddhist before you're given the blue card. That is our ideology. Our ideology is that 69 lakh girls get the scheme, which is a WABE Kanyashri scheme, which got a UN award, unlike a Beti Bachao, where more than 70% of the Beti Bachao expenditure is based on advertising. That is our ideology. So when you talk about ideology, you have to talk to me about facts. Our ideology is, when you say you will double farmer income, the Honorable Prime Minister said it, he said he'll double farmer income by 2022. at current rates, that will not happen before 2028. Mamata Banerjee didn't double farmer income in Bengal from 2011 to now. She's tripled farmer income. This is ideology. There's a difference between ideology and hype. You can change your t-shirt. You can change your shawl. You can change your kurta. But you can't change your ideology. If you really had ideology, why aren't you talking about demonetization anymore? If you really have ideology, why did you all oppose GST when you were in Gujarat?
Will this ideology sustain if there is no Mamata Banerjee? You already have an Adhir Ranjan Chaudhary who in Parliament 3 days ago said, merge with us, you're losing so many people every day.
Since he said that, and I don't know what he said, Congress could consider a demerger with the Trinamool Congress. It can happen in the reverse. It can happen in the reverse. You know, I'll tell you something. You watch the fun after May 15. After May 15, you watch. There's a lot of things which we discuss in Central Hall, which can't be discussed in conclaves. I can tell you something. Across the board, this country is looking for one man or woman who they can all rally around. And my guess is it's a woman from Eastern India.
You're saying Mamata Banerjee now will go national after this election? Is that what you're saying? Are you saying the opposition is going to rally behind the name of Mamata Banerjee and the TMC going ahead for 2024, sir?
I'm sad you used the word that Mamata Banerjee is going national. Mamata Banerjee is already international. There are a couple of international, again, positive icons who've come out of Bengal. And I'm not comparing anybody. In the 70s and 80s, we had a woman with a blue sari who went beyond national and international boundaries in a different way. No, don't mix up the two. This is a different way. I'm using it as an analogy, not to create a controversy.
Does Mamata Banerjee have prime ministerial ambitions? Because that's what you're indicating.
People will decide. Our focus now is what? Our focus is that here's the focus of the All India Trinamool Congress in the next 2 months. Focus, they're coming at you, the tourist gang, money, media power, all kinds of dirty tricks department, social media, all this pressure. And what do we have on this side? We have one lady with a team. This lady with her team, we'll take them, because this is not only about tourist gang versus Trinamool. This is a much bigger fight.
And she's going to lead this fight in 2024, you're saying? There's a woman in a white sari.
Anything I say about 2024 will be very, very inappropriate, because that means I am not focused. And the focus is 2021. In the name, it's a battle for Bengal, but it's truly a battle for all what India stands for the economy. Okay. That's the story. And I'm not a cephologist, but after the Tamil Nadu results, and after the Kerala results, no BJP, and after the Bengal results, no BJP, Assam, I'm told by my cephologist friends, BJP is slightly ahead. I don't know. I don't have information. Then the whole outlook will change, but I don't want to go there, because as I said, now it's very simple. How have we touched lives of people in Bengal? For health, for education, for food, in their outlook. That's the focus. Anything else is a distraction.
Okay. Let's talk about the current aspect of it all, where your party is concerned. Are you not getting along with your campaign manager, sir? Because there's enough going on where whoever is defecting, saying that the reason that they're doing so is because it's not Mamata Di anymore. This is another man who's at the forefront of it. Mm-hmm. Mr. Prashant Kishore.
Mr. You can't use the word legend very often, so I use it very carefully. Mr. Arun Puri is one of the legends in Indian journalism. If anything goes wonky with the India Today group, Mr. Arun Puri or Kali Puri are here, the buck stops with them. So you can't blame A, B, C, D. Let me say this on record. Mr. Prashant Kishore had a role to play in 2014 as an agency hired. That time nobody said anything. Let me say this on record. IPAC and Prashant Kishore are doing a very, very good job working with us. What are the second part of your, the people who are leaving, very good. Yesterday, you all could not ask Mamta Di some specific questions. So here it is, very simple and no big talk because there's no GST on big talk. One MLA left from Nandigram. He said, now Mamta Di will stand there and lose by 50,000 votes. Yeah. Mamta Di perhaps will win by 50,000 votes.
Why give him the time of day?
Just one second.
Run
I'll tell you
Nandigram.
Why. I'll tell you why. Because the way you all are making it out to be that people are leaving, if I leave, I have to go somewhere to fight. If you are an MLA and you leave, you fight from that seat. No. 3-4 of them have left. So 3-4, and that's good. Actually, it's very good because when you have a team, when you have a full team of 218 MLAs and 35 MPs, 3-4, it's better you go now because otherwise, BJP, even when they lose an election, this is the new trend, they try and win an election after the election.
But sir, if
so that will not happen.
If he's so inconsequential.
Who?
The Nandigram person you're talking about, is if Mr. Suvendu Adhikari is so inconsequential, why give him the time of day and Mamata Banerjee fight against him? Why?
The reasons are strategic.
Okay.
The reasons are strategic. I can give you a example which would be unrelated to this. You know, let's say there's a journalist of yours who's running your Mumbai office for last 15 years, and that journalist goes. So obviously you'll have to step in and do your bit. I think it's a challenge. I think it's a challenge because there are a lot of people who are wanting to appropriate that story, the struggle of Nandigram. So there are a lot of people who are trying to appropriate the struggle of Nandigram. So this will set it right once and for all.
Sir, we're out of time. I'm going to ask you one question, and it's actually a compliment I'd like to give you. You know, when we talk about freedom of expression, all of that, that's debatable. It's arguable where your state's record is concerned. But what is fabulous in your state record and your party record is the representation of women that you give at the Gram Panchayat level in the parliament as well. How do you get them? How does it work? Like I had Nusrat yesterday and she was like, you know, when I got the call by Mamta, it was Mamata Banerjee who picked her, hand-picked her.
There's an interesting point about beyond Trinamool about women's reservation, you see. It's a serious issue. So we should take it Trinamool and beyond Trinamool. The firstly is when you say women's reservation, we're not only talking about giving 33 1/3% seats.
I admit you have a good record
ticket,
there.
Tickets.
Not in freedom of expression,
no,
but
I'm telling
yes.
you what is the solution. In a conclave like this, let's offer a solution how to enshrine this. So the first thing which this government needs to do is bring the women's reservation bill and please bring it in the Rajya Sabha. Why Rajya Sabha? Because then the bill will be permanent, it will not lapse. Number two, it's important. Number two, Trinamool doesn't need the women's reservation bill because it's 41% women in Lok Sabha and 31% in Rajya Sabha. This is the way it is. However, so I think there can be a broad consensus on this. It's not only the MPs, it's the MLAs and it's down the line. The problem here is, and that's why Parliament should do this in March, I'm sure the Congress party will join. I'm sure the communists will have no problem. The problem will be somewhere else. Because the ideologues of the BJP, the original rumors...
Let me finish.
What is their view on women, which is the rumor spreading society?
So I'll talk about your own state at the Gram Panchayat level. Out of 5,029, if I'm not wrong, 2,000, which won from the BJP, are women. So let's not get there because that, in terms of just figures...
You see, I've spent a lot of time, again, everything discussed in Central Hall sometimes remains in Central Hall, but Sushma ji, may her soul rest in peace. So women have to be empowered, and it's not only about MPs. And I think when it comes to women empowerment, again, you have to look at numbers. We don't have time. I'd have given you 3-4 numbers where women are empowered.
I complimented you in the beginning. I said you've done a tremendous
job.
But
no, but it's Preeti, it's not enough. It's not enough. We now need to take it to the next step. We need to convince this, the BJP, who draws their inspiration from someone else, who are basically have a, and where they draw it from, it's a completely misogynistic view. So we need to convert, we need to do it by legislation, not by discussing it at conclaves. So bring the bill, discuss it. It's already got lapsed twice. Bring the bill, discuss it, and let's pass this bill in Parliament.
Okay, with that, We conclude this session, sir. Appreciate it. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please raise a warm applause for Mr. Derek O'Brien. Thank you, sir. Thank you.